And I studied tourism, rec, and event management with a geography minor. And right after graduation, I knew I wanted to go on a meaningful mission trip, because I wanted to do that my whole life, but never had time because I was in school. And I talked to Jesse and Kristen Kroll about options, and they told me about this group called Biome, and I'd never heard of it, and I didn't know anything about it, but I Googled it, and it seems like a good thing to do. So I did that in January, and the next page we'll describe a bit about it. So my program was called a Discipleship Training School, which is DTS program, that's what we called it. And it's a 5-month program. So 3 months are a lecture phase in the US, and 2 months are outreach. And I chose to go to the base in Montana in the city of Lakeside. And I did that because I worked in Montana 4 summers ago, and it was my favorite experience of my life. So I knew I wanted to go back to Montana for sure. So I picked a base and a location that I knew I loved. And on the next page, so lecture phase was January through March of this year. And I was in Montana during winter, which is awesome, because I've never experienced winter before. And so what we did, we had 12 weeks of lecture, and there were pastors from all over the world that came and spoke about various topics. For example, we talked about the Father and Heart of God, grace and holiness, intimacy with Jesus in a secular world, spiritual warfare, and then a week on Holy Spirit. So we had, so we had lectures every week by pastors, and then we had work duties also. So every afternoon, somebody had a job on base, so whether that was cleaning or cooking dinner, or just various things that needed to be done on campus. And my work duty was shoveling snow, which was awesome that I picked that because I wanted to experience shoveling snow. So it was fun. I did it for 2 hours every day. So, and that's a picture, kind of blurry, but those are the two girls that I shoveled with every day, and then our leader. And after we shoveled, we'd always make a fire and have s'mores to reward ourselves for the hard work. So that was a fun memory of winter that I have. And on the next page, so also in the lecture phase, we did a lot of small group and one-on-one discipleship. So we were able to have any questions answered with staff. So there was 12 people on staff, mostly in their mid to late 20s. And these people are in Lakeside, Montana year-round, and they lead trips overseas. So they have like 3 months of pouring in, 3 months in the States of like discipling us, and then they lead us to the country. So I got really close to a lot of the girls on staff. And also, we would have Friday night community nights in the city of Kalispell, which is a city like 30 minutes north of where I was. It's smaller than Fort Myers, but it's the biggest city near the little town. And we would, that's a picture of a homeless shelter. We met there every Friday night and served dinner at the house and just talked to the families. And we would lead kids programs at local churches. And we would go to Target in the mall and do random evangelism. Practice walking up to strangers, which is terrifying at first, because people in Montana like their space. They're not very friendly sometimes in public, so that was kind of hard. But it was good practice, because in Nepal, that's what we did a lot, just walked up to random people. And on the next page, you can see, also in lecture phase, we spent 1 week in Seattle, Washington on something called mini outreach, which was just 7 days where we took a van and drove it to Montana. From Montana to Seattle in February during a blizzard. That was terrifying. And so in Seattle, we served dinner at a women and a children's home, and we did evangelism in downtown. And that picture is a Pike's Place Market. If anybody's been to downtown, it's a giant shopping center, fish market. It's where all the tourists go. So we went to Seattle and just practiced again talking to random people. And we led a youth group in a church also in Seattle. And so another thing we did in Montana was we had a book of the Bible assigned to us every week, and we would have to read it out loud in one sitting, and then we discussed it every Monday. So for example, Genesis took 5 hours to read out loud, but then like Jonah took 3 minutes. So it would surprise us with books. So the Genesis week was definitely hard. So we would just discuss it in depth, and that was really cool. It gave me a new appreciation for the word, which I never really read before. Well, intently. And next page, these are just some pictures of winter. So the left page is a car, buried. I didn't really know what to do, but it was fun. I got boots and I walked around. And on the right is me skiing, kind of hard to see, crashed right after that picture was taken. It's very beautiful, but it was fun. And I can see why people like it, and I really want to get into it and move out west. And the next picture, so on the right, it's me and my friend snowshoeing. So it's basically a tennis racket that you strap on your foot with like spikes on it so you don't sink in the snow. So almost every day, every weekend, I would just go snowshoeing on the trails. And the left picture, that's my Nepal team. So to physically train for Nepal, we would go on snowshoe hikes because we knew the elevation would get to us. So we did a lot of snowshoeing. And so now, moving on to March. So January through March, I was in Montana doing lectures and snowshoeing and going to Seattle. And then in March, I went to Nepal. And you can see there, it's a very tiny country, pancaked in between India and China. So it's just north of India and south of China. And yeah, it's a very small country, but very diverse geographically. So this video will give you a better idea of what it looks like, and then I'll talk more specifically. Predominantly Hindu. It says it's 83%, but it really felt like 99%. everybody is Hindu. Buddhism and Islam have a very small portion, a tribal religion, and then 1% Christian, which feels like 0.1%. There's barely anybody there. And so it's a very poor country, only about $1 per person per day is average income. The average lifespan is only 55 years old, and that's very rare. Only children and business owners know English, so that was a language barrier that was very hard. And if kids drop out of school to help their family, then they don't perfect their English, so it's very, very difficult to communicate with people there. And the next slide, you can see, so our focus was teaching. That was the main point of the trip. We went to 4 of the 5 regions of Nepal, which are kind of like states, so we went to 4 of the 5. So we were never in the same village for more than 5 days. We were always traveling. We had a 24-hour bus ride and a 21-hour jeep ride included in that. So we don't like jeeps anymore. We mainly stayed at churches, just on the floor in sleeping bags. And the last week, we were in the home of an American missionary. So the main teaching we did was a mini DTS seminar, and DTS stands for Discipleship Training School, what I did in Montana. So we talked for 8 hours, we do 4 hours and a lunch break, and then 4 more. And everybody on our team picked our favorite week from lecture phase and then made a teaching on that. So I picked Grace and Holiness from lecture phase, and then I made a teaching on it, and we would present that over 20 times the whole trip. Every church we went to, we shared that. In the picture, you can, it's kind of blurry, but you can tell everybody's sitting on the ground. And the women sit on the left, and the men sit on the right. And if it's not your husband, you can't look a man in the eye, because it means you're flirting with them. So that was very hard to do, because as Americans, we want to look at people in the eye to be intentional. So church is a very serious affair there. And everybody wears this outfit that I'm wearing. All the women have to wear a tunic that covers everything. And men just have to wear pants. And on the next slide, so that's me teaching, and so we each bought 2 tunics, that's my other one. And so we would stand up there next to our contact, who's obviously is from Nepal, so he speaks Nepali. So we would have like an hour long time slot, but only 30 minutes of talking, because we would have to wait for him to translate. So it was kind of nice, because it let you collect your thoughts while they were translating. And the other teaching we did was a Bible overview, because a lot of, like, most pastors in Nepal don't know the whole Bible, they only know the gospel. So for us to teach them a very simplified version of the whole Bible, so we did a 4-hour long seminar over from Genesis to Revelation, very compact, but it was something they'd never heard before. So those are the 8 topics that we talked about, and everybody on our team picked one. I talked about creation, and then people talked about the others. And it was really emotional because the pastors were taking notes like crazy or crying while they were taking notes because they'd never heard of it. One pastor at the end told me, I've never heard of Adam or Eve until today because they just don't have literature and no one tells them. So they only know about the Gospels. They don't even know there's a second coming. So like for us to share the fall of man and then to like go through the list and then tell them about the Holy Spirit, they've never heard of the Holy Spirit. And this is a pastor. So pastors there feel they're mostly shy and timid, and they're afraid to talk because they don't know anything. So for us to give them the Bible overview was really cool because it gave them confidence in their congregation. And they all, they were taking notes like crazy, and then they asked for copies of our notes, and there's no computers, so we couldn't do that. But yeah, they were really interested, and everybody that goes to church is very passionate, and they want to know everything. On the next slide, you can see, so after church, first of all, a lot of Hindu people came to our churches, and they didn't come because it was a church, they came because white people were there, so word spreads really quick when Americans are in a village, so they would just come, they called it a show, they thought we were going to put on some kind of acrobatic performance, but we just talked. So they would, like, 15 or 20 Hindu ladies would just, like, pop in the back door and expect us to do something miraculous, and then we're like, we're just preaching, like, you can stay. So they would sit in the back, and we all thought they would leave, because we thought they'd be offended by what we were saying, but then they stayed. And this lady stayed and talked to me for hours, and she was saying that she had to leave the house without her husband knowing, because he beats her, and he's always drunk, and if she even mentions going to church, he goes into a rage, so she was afraid to go home, and she wanted our team to come and right over their house, but it's a 2-hour walk. So we couldn't, because we have somewhere to be. But yeah, so their communities are very curious, but they're terrified of their husbands, and they're terrified of their sister, and they're terrified of the whole village just shunning them. So it's a very, it's like they're walking on eggshells but when they go to church. So yeah, next slide. So another aspect of our trip was hiking. So that's the reason, one of the main reasons why I picked Nepal when they presented the countries in Montana. So we had a choice of either Cambodia, Thailand, or Nepal. And I didn't want humidity and I wanted hiking, so I picked Nepal. It was still very humid. It felt like Florida a lot. There was palm trees and mango trees and a lot of mosquitoes. So I didn't really escape Florida. So that picture is us hiking. It's kind of hard to tell, but in the top, the white area, those are the Himalayas, and they're covered in snow. That's why we can't really see them. So we were looking at them as we were hiking, which was awesome. It's been a dream of mine forever. So we spent 2 weeks in a region called Bugu, which is very remote. We didn't wash our hands or shower for 2 weeks. No cell service. Very interesting. So we hiked to two different churches and spent 1 week in each place. And every time we met someone on the trail, whether they were Nepali or a tourist, we would share the gospel with them. And we did seminars when we got to the churches, the Bible review seminar. And on the next page, that's just what a village would look like. So we would just be walking, and then people would stop milking their cow or doing whatever they were doing and just surround us and stare because they thought we were going to put on some kind of show. Always thinking we're going to do some kind of show. So then the translator would just point to one of us and say, go, start sharing the gospel. And we would still be sweating and trying to catch our breath from hiking. It's very irritating, but so we had to like gulp and like wipe the sweat out of our eyes and then just start talking to a group of 50 people with translation about the gospel. And sometimes people liked it, sometimes they didn't, and they would yell and cuss at us and walk away, but there were a lot of people that stayed and really wanted to hear. Next slide. So on the left, that just means a group of construction workers that were building a sidewalk. So I shared the gospel with them. And the right is just kids playing on the ground like they always do. They don't go to school, is not enforced at all. You can drop out any day. The government doesn't really care. So a lot of kids are not in school. Next slide. So that just shows some more of the geography. Rice is the biggest export consuming ingredient of life. So there's rice everywhere, and that's the terrace that they built. And it's emerald green. It's really great. All the grass is really bright and green. And then the next slide, you can see that's my team on horses. So we hiked for many days, and then people got food poisoning. I had blisters, and my feet were bleeding. Another girl was very sick, and we didn't know how we would get to the next church. Like, it was, like, we physically could not hike anymore. And then our contact found a horseback riding company out of nowhere and said if we all paid 10 extra dollars, we could ride horses to the next church. And I hate horses, but I almost cried because I was so happy. So I paid $10 and I got on the donkey horse thing, and we rode through a national park in Nepal on a horse. It was really fun. And they were very trained and not scary. And then we got to this lake, and yeah, so the hiking was very difficult, much more difficult than I've ever done in Colorado or Montana or Wyoming. And then the next page, you see, so those are the Sherpas. The Sherpa just means someone who carries your things. And these were always like 13-year-old boys who dropped out of school to raise money to help the family. So they know a little English, but not much because they left school. And so they were tiny little boys, and they would carry our 50-pound backpacks and walk next to us as we rode the horse. And then that was my Sherpa, he wanted a picture. So he jumped on my horse and ran in the water, and then the horse started charging me. That's my favorite. The white of the water is moving because he was running really fast. So that was interesting. And then next, so after the 2 weeks of very remote hiking, we were very thankful to be in a city called Pokhara, which is the tourist capital of the city. 7 of the 10 highest mountains in the world are near Pokhara, so it's a huge, huge hub for climbers from all over the world. Like New Zealand and Europe are the most popular, the most athletic climbers that come there. And you can see in the picture, so the city is on a lake, and the Himalayas are just like towering above it. It's stunning. And there's, yeah, tourists everywhere. So we stayed with American missionaries. They were from Colorado, so they cooked us American food, and they had showers and a toilet, and soap. I've never been more happy to see liquid soap in my entire life. And so that week was a business as missions week. So in Nepal, Americans can only get a visa if they have a business, or else the government gets really suspicious why they're there. So we got a tour of four American couples who started businesses in Pokhara. So we went to a juice factory, this couple from Washington that made mango and orange juice, like fresh squeezed. We went to a bed and breakfast. This couple, they worked in hospitality in the state, so they opened a hotel for hikers. And then a mountain biking outfitter, this couple from Utah that was really into biking, started a training course for Nepali men to get their biking certification so they can lead tours off. And then the farm and aquaponics site was a fourth one, and the couple we stayed with, they were the farmers. So we stayed with farmers for a week, so we ate really well, so we had really fresh food. And the next page, so also during that week, so we worked on the farm for 3 days with the Colorado couple, and we harvested sprouts and tea leaves to sell at the market, and that's a picture of us at the farmer's market. So we got to witness as we were giving people honey and lemongrass. And we painted rooms in the bed and breakfast because the couple, they had four kids, so they had no time to like make the place look nice. We painted the whole hotel for them. It was only 8 rooms of bed and breakfast, so now they can get more tourists and help their business grow. And we went to an orphanage and played soccer and helped kids with their English homework. And we went to the touristy region and did street evangelism just to tourists from all over the world, so that was really fun. And the next page, you can see those are just strawberry plants that we planted. So we spent a whole day planting 30 of those. So let's see if I'm going to plant strawberries again. Yeah, so just to close, I want to give you guys some points of how you can pray for Nepal. I'm sure most of you have never even heard of it because it's such a small country in the middle of nowhere. But you've heard of Mount Everest, so this is where that is. And it's a huge tourist country. So here are some things you can remember. So the main point is that the kids should stay in school. Because usually when a kid is 11 or 12, they realize they can make money either guiding horses or working in a coffee shop in a touristy city, so they just drop out. So pray that kids would stay in school to improve their English and then better their community. That the Hindu people would encounter Christians and just be receptive to them and not walk away. Pray for the pastors, because they're all very shy and feel like they don't have anything important to say. So pray that they will use our Bible overview and actually preach that to people. Pray for no more alcoholism, because that's really affecting marriages, and especially Hindu men are perpetually drunk and angry. Just pray for that. Healthy crops, because a lot of people earn their living with their water buffalo. So pray for healthy cows and livestock and buffalo. And also for tourism, because that is a huge employer and a way to make money around the big mountains. And that's just a picture of my favorite 3 kids. They meow at me like a cat and color me pictures and hug me every day. So, all right, that's about it. So thank you for supporting me. If anybody donated when I was here in Nepal or if you prayed for me, it's really appreciated. Many days, I would just think about all the prayers and faces of people that care about me and that got me through. So I feel much more confident in the gospel, and I realize I've never shared that before in America, so it's not something you do in Target, but after doing it in Montana, I really got confident with it, so that was nice, and it was a great experience altogether, more challenging than I thought, but it got better, hopefully. So this summer, I'm going to be working in Alaska at a hotel in Glacier Bay National Park near Chino. So if you can pray for me there, it's nothing mission-related, I'm just working at a hotel, but I can make it mission-related if I want to, so pray that I have good coworkers. And there's a lot of international people that work at National Park Lodges, so I'm praying for a really good roommate who I can talk to and find out where she's from. So that's it. Thank you.